Hello everyone, so this is Dr. Khalid Imran. I welcome you to the lecture series of the third session on elements of mechanical engineering for module 5, that is machine tools and advanced manufacturing processes. So in the previous class we had seen many operations which are performed on a lathe, we had a turning operation followed by facing operation, then you had seen the thread cutting operation, so on and so forth. So followed by this operation, which is drilling operation. So these are the operations we discussed. We have discussed turning operation, facing operation, thread cutting operation, and knurling operation. So there are two more operations which are left out. One is the taper turning operation, then we have drilling operation. So the operations such as turning operation, facing, thread cutting, knurling operation, all these are inherent operations which can be performed on a lathe very conveniently. Whereas other operations like drilling operation, then we have boring operation, reaming operation, grinding operation, milling operation, these operations can also be performed on other machine tools. Like as we had discussed earlier, grinding operation can be performed on a grinding machine. Then we have tapping operation can be performed on a drilling machine. Drilling operation, boring operation, these operations can also be performed on drilling machines, on the respective machine tools. Since we know that lathe is the mother of all machine tools, the other operations which can be performed on other machine tools like parting, tapping, a chamfering operation, your reaming, milling operation, grinding operation, these operations can also be performed on a lathe. So after having discussed turning, facing, thread cutting, taper turning, not taper turning, knurling operation, let us discuss drilling operation. So basically, drilling operation is an operation by the help of which we can make holes of desired diameter. So we have cutting tool, which is a multi-point cutting tool. So this multi-point cutting tool can make holes to the desired diameter in different materials. Like as we discussed earlier, a drilling machine can be a portable drilling machine, it can be a handheld drilling machine, it can be a sensitive drilling machine, it can be a radial drilling machine, likewise. And the important tool which is held in the drilling machine is a drill bit. So we can also see that the drilling machine can accommodate other tools like reamers, taps and all. But one of the most fundamental operation of a drilling machine is drilling a hole using standard drill bits. So a drill bit, if you see this particular figure here, this particular part is your drill bit. And this drill bit can be made up of high speed steel. And drilling operation, besides being performed on a drilling machine, can also be used as an auxiliary operation in a lathe. So in a lathe, this part is known as the drill chuck. As we have a chuck in a lathe, like a 3-jaw chuck and a 4-jaw chuck, we have 3-jaw independent chuck and 3-jaw universal chuck and 4-jaw independent chuck. Similarly, we have a chuck which is a tool holding device. This entire chuck can be held in the tailstock. So this part is the tailstock, wherein the chuck is inserted in the tailstock spindle. So here we have a small collet. A collet is nothing but it contains the jaws in the front portion, which can hold the work very comfortably. So you have a cavity here. By using a chuck key, we can grip the drill bit in the drill chuck. And when the drill chuck is advanced, or when it is pierced through the rotating workpiece, this is the workpiece which is held in the chuck on a lathe. So you can also see this figure, wherein we have a chuck, then we have a workpiece, and this is the tailstock part. And this part is your quill, tailstock quill. So inside the tailstock quill, one can insert the drill chuck. In the drill chuck, the drill bit is held of the given diameter, of the desired diameter. So the job is rotating here. The job is made to rotate, and the drill bit is pierced inside the job so that a hole is created. On the other hand, in a drilling machine, the job is stationary, and the drill bit is rotating, and the drill bit is also given a linear movement. That is a real difference. In actual drilling operation, in a drilling machine, The workpiece is stationary. It is held in a work holding device like a vise, and then the drill bit is fed against the stationary job. The drill bit is rotating, the cutting tool is rotating, as well as it is moving in a linear direction to accomplish the feed, wherein we get the hole of the suitable diameter equal to the diameter of the drill bit. Though the diameter of the hole which is obtained will be slightly larger than the diameter of the drill bit, so we get a hole of the required size. In order to get holes of different diameters, user-defined diameters, then the preferred operation is boring operation. So boring operation is one such operation wherein you can increase the previously drilled hole. So in a lathe, drilling can be performed in this manner by holding the drill chuck in the tailstock and by holding the workpiece in the chuck, so that when the chuck rotates, even the job rotates, and when the job rotates, in the rotating job, when the drill is pierced or forced inside, you get a hole of the desired diameter. So things will be more clearer if at all you watch this video. This is the drill chuck and this is the drill bit. You can see this is the tail stock. And by moving the handle of the tail stock, you can see the drill chuck is advancing. So you can have both forward position, you can move it forward and you can take it backward by rotating the tail stock handle. That is the coolant which is being poured at the tool work interface. The job is held in the chuck, you can see this. Now this is a bigger drill bit. It's a multi-point cutting tool. You can see the flutes, the cutting edges of the drill bit are one of the flutes here, and this is the lip angle of the drill bit. So initially, we use a small drill bit to make a small hole. The same hole is being enlarged now by using the bigger drill bit. You can see the material, unwanted material is removed in form of small chips, metal chips, which will fall inside the tray. So I hope all of you have understood drilling operation very clearly. The next operation is a taper turning by swiveling the compound rest. See, the fundamental objective of a lathe is to produce circular parts. Besides producing circular parts, it also produces tapered components. So like, you know, taper turning is one such operation by the virtue of which we can produce taper components. Like at one end the diameter is bigger, and at the other end the diameter is smaller over the given length of the workpiece. So taper turning is an operation on a lathe to produce conical surfaces on the workpiece. So taper turning can be accomplished by three methods. The first method is taper turning by swiveling the compound tool rest. The second method is taper turning by offsetting the tailstock. And the third method is taper turning by taper turning attachment. So as far as your syllabus is concerned, taper turning by taper turning attachment is not there. We have only two methods. One is taper turning by swiveling the compound tool rest, and the second method is taper turning by offsetting the tailstock. So the very first method, taper turning by swiveling the compound rest. Here is the job. This is the workpiece which is held in the chuck. The chuck is not shown in the figure here. And here you have the compound rest, nothing but the compound tool rest. This compound tool rest can be swiveled to desire, can be swiveled to any angle. You can change the orientation of it. The entire compound tool rest can be rotated to any angle, and this angle is obtained by using a simple trigonometric relation like alpha is equal to tan inverse of capital D minus small d divided by twice the length of it. means capital D refers here to the major diameter, the bigger diameter here. Small d refers to this minor diameter, and L refers to the length of the specimen, not the tapered length, but the parallel straight length, length parallel to the axis of the job. So the tool is mounted in the tool post. This part is the tool post, and the tool post is resting on the compound slide. You have a small hand wheel. By rotating this hand wheel, the entire compound tool rest can move in a linear direction. So the job is held straight in the chuck so that the axis of the workpiece or the job is in line with the axis of the lathe. So it is collinear. Both the axes are collinear here. And what is made inclined? The compound tool rest is made inclined. It is given an angle. This the entire compound tool rest is swiveled. It can be rotated about 360 degrees. So we have to set an angle of alpha, wherein alpha is equal to tan inverse of capital D minus small d divided by twice the length of the workpiece. Using this particular formula, once we get the angle here, the compound tool rest is swiveled to the desired angle and it is locked in that particular position. Now, when the compound tool rest is, when the handle of this compound tool rest is rotated slowly and manually, what we get is a conical surface like this. See, the job is rotating in the chuck. Now, when the tool is moved not parallel to the job, but inclined to the job, where the angle of inclination is equal to the obtained angle, then we get a conical surface in this fashion. See, in this particular operation, one can get very steep tapers for a very short length. You can see the length of the job or the workpiece, it is very, very small. But one of the major advantage of this is, we can get a very steep taper here, a very steep taper. The taper angle is very large. You can see the operation in this particular video.
Now I explain the swiveling compound rest taper turning method on this specimen. Inside the jaws, tightening, loose the compound rest screws. See this scale? I will take the compound rest angle. This to this. Can take the 20 degrees. Screw. So, tie the screw. Take the cross feed. Front side of the specimen. This method is limited to turn a short taper only.
So you can see the tool. This is a single point cutting tool which is used to create the taper here, to make the taper. This is, it is held in the tool post. We know that the tool post is resting on the compound rest, and when the compound rest hand wheel is rotated, you can see the taper being generated here on the workpiece. So you can witness the minor diameter and the major diameter, the smaller diameter at this end and the bigger diameter at this end. The iron filings, the ribbons, the scrap is coming out of the material, the unwanted material is being cut in form of chips or ribbons. And now this is the hand wheel. This is the cross light. This is the cross light hand wheel. And this hand wheel which is operating on this side is the compost light hand wheel. So it has to be moved manually. You can see the inclination here. The axis of the workpiece and the axis of the lathe are collinear, whereas the entire compound rest is swiveled to the desired angle. I hope the taper turning operation by swiveling the compound rest is clear to you. The next operation is taper turning but tailstock offset method. The alternate name is set over method also. See, in the previous case we had seen that the tool was inclined to the axis, whereas in this case the workpiece itself is, you know, inclined to the axis of the lathe. How exactly? So we have the tailstock which can be shifted to the adjacent guideways. So we have guideways on the lathe bed. When the tailstock is shifted from its initial position on a particular guideway to the adjacent guideway, then what happens is there will be an inclination which will be automatically produced like this, so that the job which is held between the centers, this is a live center and this is a dead center. The job is held between the live center of a chuck and dead center in a tailstock. When the entire tailstock is offset, you can see the angle generated here. So with respect to the obtained angle, when the jaw, when the tool is moved exactly in a linear direction, we get the desired taper. Here the compound rest is not swiveled. You can see the tool. The tool is held in the tool post and the tool post is resting on the compound slide. This compound slide is resting on the cross slide, and once again the cross slide is present on the, it is resting on the saddle. This entire assembly, like, you know, when this particular hand wheel, which is the carriage assembly hand wheel, is rotated, the entire carriage assembly moves exactly in a rectilinear direction or in a linear motion. When it is linearly moved all along the length of the workpiece, since the workpiece itself is inclined on account of the offset in the tailstock position, then we get the taper, the desired taper here. So one of the major advantage here is we can get taper on huge lengthy pieces, unlike your taper turning operation by swiveling the compound rest method. In this particular method, which is tailstock offset method, one can achieve lengthy tapers but not steep tapers. The amount of taper what we get is very, very small in case of tailstock offset method. To overcome this, to overcome the limitations in both the methods, we have one more method known as taper turning attachment method. So in the first operation, in the first taper turning operation, the drawback was, though we had steep tapers, but the length was limited. In the second method, taper turning, that is tailstock, tailstock offset method, though the length of the workpiece is bigger, but the amount of taper is very, very less. So in one operation, the length is a limitation. In second operation, the angle is a limitation. In order to overcome both the limitations, we have one more operation. By using a taper turning attachment, one can accomplish, you know, tapered objects with both steep lengths on lengthier objects. But as far as your syllabus is concerned, we don't have, you know, taper turning by taper turning attachment method. So you can witness this, you can watch this video wherein taper turning by tailstock offset method is shown. It is an animation. So you can see this is the specimen. This is a face plate. It is a work holding device with a lathe dog. This is known as a lathe dog, which is attached to the face plate. So a chuck or a face plate, both are work holding devices. So you can once again watch this. So this is the taper being generated. You can see there is a shift in the position of your tailstock. The axis of the tailstock is not aligned with the axis of the lathe. If this is the axis of the lathe, you can see there is an offset. This offset will create the required taper. I hope the taper turning operation by tailstock offset method is very clear to you guys. The next topic is specification of a lathe. Yeah, before purchasing any product, be it an industrial product or a domestic product, we need to know the nomenclature of a product. So the nomenclature or specification mean the same. Here, if at all you want to purchase a lathe or procure a lathe, we need to know the following terminology very, very well. So we have important terminologies or nomenclature, or I can say specification, like swing diameter. So swing diameter is the maximum diameter of the workpiece which can be accommodated between the centers here. So this is your headstock, this is your tailstock, this is the lathe bed what you have. So on the lathe bed, the tailstock can be moved all along the length of the guideways, and headstock is stationary. This particular option, like, you know, you have a lathe wherein there is a gap in the bed. If at all there is a gap in the bed, in that type of lathe is called gap bed lathe, right? So both the, like, you know, this is a gap bed lathe. If it is a gap bed lathe, then the swing diameter increases. In a ordinary lathe wherein there is no gap in the bed, in that case the swing diameter is limited to this height, like this will be closed, this entire portion will be closed here. So if it is a gap bed lathe, the swing diameter increases. So what is swing diameter? The maximum diameter which can be accommodated in a lathe is known as swing diameter. That is one specification. If it is a gap bed lathe, then we say that the maximum diameter of the workpiece which can be accommodated in a gap bed lathe is the specification of it. Next, we have the second specification as the overall length of the job. Overall length of the job is nothing but the distance between centers. What is the maximum length of the job which can be placed between the headstock and tailstock, which can be gripped in a chuck and which can be supported by a live or dead center in the tailstock? That defines the distance between the centers. One more specification is the overall length of the bed. What is the overall length of the bed from this left hand portion, left hand side to right hand side? Besides that, besides these specifications, we do have specifications as there are how many feet, how many speeds, depending upon the type of gearbox incorporated in the lathe. So this is about the specification of a lathe. I hope it is clear. The next topic is your milling machines. So a milling machine is a power operated machine tool in which the workpiece mounted on the moving table is machined to various shapes when moved under a slow revolving serrated cutter. Now when we state the tool as a cutter here, cutter is a multi-point cutting tool. So if you see a single point cutting tool which was there in a lathe, using a single point cutting tool, many operations like turning operation, taper turning operation, thread cutting operations were accomplished. Whereas a drill bit was a multi-point cutting tool. Since it had multiple cutting edges, we call that one as a multi-point cutting tool. In the same way, a cutter is also a multi-point cutting tool which is having multiple cutting edges to remove the unwanted material. The major difference between a lathe and a milling machine here is, in a lathe, the job is rotated and the tool is fed against the rotating job, the rotating workpiece. On the other hand, in a milling machine, the job is held stationary in the vise or on the table. On a table, you will be having a work holding device. The work holding device is a vise, V-I-C-E, vise, in which the job is held securely. And then you have a rotating cutter which moves against the job. When it moves against the job, it will remove the unwanted material from the job. So as per the definition, a milling machine is a power operated machine tool in which the workpiece mounted on the moving table is machined to various shapes and various sizes when moved under a slow revolving serrated cutter. On the other hand, just milling is an operation in which they use a serrated cutter to remove the unwanted material. So this is the principle of milling. All the most of the horizontal, there are different types of milling machines. Like we have horizontal milling machine, then we do have vertical milling machine. There is a universal milling machine, planar milling machine, then omniversal milling machine. There are different types of milling machines. This principle of milling holds good to horizontal milling operation. But this is the fundamental principle of milling, wherein this is the milling cutter, which is a multi-point cutter, a serrated cutter. These are the cutting teeth of the cutter. And the cutter is held in a supporting member known as arbor, like a shaft, A-R-B-O-R. This hatched portion signifies the arbor. And you can see a small keyway here. So here, this entire cutter is keyed or locked with the arbor by help of a key. A key is a small piece of metal which is inserted between the keyways. So you will be having an opening, a groove here. A groove will be available both in the shaft, that is in the arbor, as well as in the cutter. So like the arbor and cutter are keyed together by means of a key. So that when power is given to the arbor, when the arbor rotates either in a clockwise or in anti-clockwise direction, the cutter also rotates along with this. And you have the workpiece which can be moved either against the rotating milling cutter or can be moved in the direction of the rotating cutter. So you can see the direction of rotation, both these figures indicate clockwise rotation of the milling cutter. But here at the bottom you can see the workpiece being moved. One workpiece is being moved against the rotating cutter and one workpiece is fed with the milling cutter in the direction of the rotation. It is opposite. This figure signifies the movement of the workpiece in the direction opposite to the rotating cutter. So this operation is known as the conventional milling and this operation is known as climb milling. So what happens exactly is, when we move the workpiece or when the workpiece is fed against the milling cutter, then the workpiece, the chip which is being removed, the raw material which is being removed, gets progressively thicker. Initially it will be thinner, progressively it becomes thicker and thicker and thicker. So here lies more amount of force, high amount of force is exerted by the cutter on the workpiece. If the workpiece is not securely clamped, there are chances that the workpiece may come out of the vise, that is the work holding device. One more principle of milling is your climb milling. One is conventional milling, one is climb milling. In climb milling, you can see the workpiece fed with the milling cutter, means it is fed in the direction of the rotating cutter. You can see the direction of the rotating cutter is in clockwise. Even the direction of this particular workpiece is in the direction of the rotation of the milling cutter. So here the teeth enters is in such a way that initially the thickness of the chip will be bigger, then it progressively becomes thinner and thinner. So like this operation is quite smooth compared to this operation, conventional milling operation. So if at all the workpiece is free from all sorts of scales, you have the raw material. The raw material should not have very rough surface on the top of it. It should be free from all scales. If that is the case, then your climb milling is recommended. Otherwise, conventional milling is far more suitable. Right? So this is the principle of milling operation. One is your conventional milling. One is your climb milling. In conventional milling, the workpiece is fed against the milling cutter. And in climb milling, workpiece is fed with the milling cutter or in the direction of the rotating milling cutter. So these are the types of milling machines. We have different types of milling machines. As I told you earlier, we can have plane or horizontal milling machine. There can be a vertical milling machine. We have universal milling machine, then fixed bed type or manufacturing type, in which we have three different types: simplex, duplex and triplex. Then we have a planar type milling machine. Finally, we have a profile cutting milling machine. We don't have all the milling machines in your syllabus. We have only horizontal or plane milling machine and vertical milling machine. So let us discuss horizontal milling machine, plane or horizontal milling machine. So this is the figure of horizontal milling machine. The horizontal milling machine has these essential parts. One is the base, one is the column, and you have an overhanging arm. There is a arbor, then there is a table and saddle and knee. These are the key elements of a horizontal milling machine. The base is made up of cast iron. Even the column, the overhanging arm, all these things made up of cast iron. Since cast iron can absorb more vibrations, the entire column and the base is made up of cast iron. So I can say the base, the column are an integral part of it. But the overhanging arm, it can be an integral part or it can be a different part. It can be a part which is assembled to the entire column. What does the column have inside? The column will be having various mechanisms. You will be having a huge motor inside here by the help of which all the mechanisms are functional. You will be having a huge motor and you will be having other mechanisms like elevating mechanism. You will be having the mechanism, you will be having a small motor here so that the arbor can rotate. Like either you can have a pulley here, a pulley mechanism, or a small gearbox. So at the bottom, you will be at the bottom, the motor will be housed and power is transmitted from this electric motor to the, you know, the gearbox or to a pulley here, a stepped cone pulley. So when the power is transmitted from the motor to the stepped cone pulley or to the gearbox, the arbor starts rotating. The arbor is having a uniform diameter all along its length except for a smaller length at the end of it. Here, the arbor will be having a taper. Now you know what is a taper. A taper component is one which will be having bigger diameter at one end and smaller diameter at the other end. So the tapered portion of the arbor will be inside the spindle. So this is the spindle. In this spindle, the tapered portion of the arbor goes, but it which is not seen here in the figure. The other end of the arbor is supported by the arbor support here. So you have an overhanging arm. At the end of the overhanging arm, you have an arbor support. And here you will be having a bearing. It can be a ball bearing, a roller bearing. And in this bearing, like, you know, the remaining portion of the arbor goes inside so that when the arbor is rotated, the amount of friction caused is less because of the presence of bearing and lubrication. Both at this end, especially at this end where there is bearing, there is sufficient amount of lubrication done. On account of the presence of bearing and lubrication, the amount of friction encountered is less. So what exactly is this? This is your cutter, milling cutter, right? So this plain milling cutter is mounted on the arbor, means it is keyed with the arbor. It is fixed with the arbor so that when the arbor rotates, even the milling cutter rotates along with it. Coming to this particular part, which is a knee is a huge casting. It's a huge casting which can be made to travel in a vertical direction. How? You'll be having guideways on this face of the column. This is the face of this column. So we have vertical guideways. The guideways can be either of a dovetail shape. See, this is a dovetail shape. You can see this here. This is a dovetail shape, like a pigeon tail. You have a pigeon tail. The shape of the pigeon tail will be like, you know, it's like a dovetail. So in the same way, the name is given with respect to the pigeon's tail here. So you have a dovetail guideway. You can see this is also a guideway here. So here you can have either the dovetail guideways or you can have rectangular or square guideways. So the knee gets elevated here. The knee goes up and down with respect to the guideways which are provided in the front face of the column. In the front face of the column. So that you have an elevating screw. When this handle, this is the handle for elevating screw. When this handle is rotated, this elevating screw, it starts rotating. When this rotates, this is meshed with the knee here. Here you'll be having a hole with threads inside, or you may have a nut inside here. So that when the nut is rotated, since the nut is meshed with this elevating screw, the knee goes up and down. But to ensure that the knee moves in a vertical direction, in a linear direction, this is supported, or this runs inside the guideways which are there in the front face of the column. Just above the knee, we have a saddle. So a saddle is one more component or one more machine component which is mounted on the knee. So this saddle will be having guideways both on the top of it and underneath. The guideways which are provided underneath the saddle, you know, they mesh along with the guideways on the knee. So you can see on the top surface of the knee here, on the top surface, the saddle is sitting, right? So this can once again be a dovetail guideway, or it can be a rectangular or a square guideway. So what happens is the handle for rotation, you can see this handle. When this handle is rotated, this entire saddle moves in a longitudinal direction from left to right and right to left. So there is one vertical movement of the knee accomplished by rotating this handle so that the elevating screw lifts the knee up and down. Above the knee, we do have the saddle. This particular saddle moves in longitudinal direction. When this hand wheel is rotated, the entire saddle moves from left to right and right to left. Above the saddle, we have the table. So the table also comprises of the guideways, now both above and below. So these are the T-slots. These are also guideways or keyways, I can say. These are the T-slots. These T's on the T-slots, you can mount the vise, that is the work holding device. There's a clamping device. So the vise is kept inside. Like, you know, you'll be having the bolt. When the bolt is inverted, the head of the bolt goes inside these T-slots. And the shank of the bolt is, you know, it's projecting on the top. So that one can place a plate and, you know, lock the entire part with the nuts. Or one can directly place a vise. And if a vise is placed here, in the vise, the work is held. Clear? So I hope this thing is clear here. So how many movements are there here? One is the vertical movement of the knee. One is the longitudinal movement of the saddle. One is the transverse movement of the table. So one is vertical movement. One is longitudinal movement. One is the transverse movement. The transverse movement of the table is accomplished by rotating this wheel. When this particular, you know, wheel is rotated, the table moves in a transverse direction, right? So by moving this particular wheel, the job can be fed against the rotating cutter. The cutter is rotating at one particular position. The arbor doesn't move. The arbor is rotating. Along with the arbor, the cutter is also rotating. Whereas the job which is held on the table, it is moved against the rotating cutter, right? So that the unwanted material from the workpiece is removed. Clear? So we can change the speeds of the arbor. So you'll be having a small gearbox inside here, which is not shown in the figure. The gearbox, the motor, or the, you know, stepped cone pulley mechanism, everything is housed inside this column. Clear? So different speeds are made available for the arbor. And the speeds are changed basically to suit the material requirements. Some materials are very, very hard, right? For example, if a cast steel is taken as the raw material, then the speed should be slower when compared to the material made up of mild steel, right? So for mild steel, the speed can be slightly higher. So this rotating cutter removes the unwanted material from the workpiece. So remember this, the cutter axis in a horizontal milling machine is always in a horizontal plane. Horizontal plane. I hope my explanation is clear to you. So you'll get a clear idea when you watch this video. Yeah, so you can see the cutter rotating here on the arbor. This is a horizontal milling machine. You have a sturdy base, you have the column, you have all the mechanism inside. You can see the face of it. You can see the face. This is the column. Column is the main supporting frame mounted vertically on the base. This is the base, this is the column. The column houses all the driving mechanisms for the spindle and the table feed, to feed the table and all. It is also provided with the guideways to slide the knee up and down. So you have the guideway on the front face of it. So So knee supports the saddle, the table, the workpiece. You can see the knee is supporting the saddle, the table, the vise, and this is the elevating screw. So you can see the saddle, it is mounted on the guideways of the knee to support and carry the table. So this is the entire table. The table, it has T slots. You can see these slots here, T slots, accurately finished top surface to hold and clamp the workpiece. Either the workpiece can be directly clamped on the table or it can be clamped on the vise. Now this is the overhanging arm. It acts as the support for this arbor. You can see one end of the arbor is supported. An arbor is an extension of the machine spindle which is mounted with the milling cutter. So the tapered part goes inside here and uniform diameter part is here. You can see the cutter rotating and this is the workpiece. The workpiece is held between the jaws of the vise. These are the jaws of the vise. Vise is the work holding device. So it is located in the upper part of the column. Its front end is called the nose, this one, the arbor. Now when the cutter is rotating, you can see when the jaw is fed against the rotating cutter, it is removing the unwanted material. I hope the working of the horizontal milling machine is very clear to you guys. So we shall stop here. Tomorrow, next class, we can discuss, we will be discussing about vertical milling machines and the operations involved in both horizontal milling machine as well as vertical milling machine. I hope you enjoyed this video. You have learned something out of this. Thank you very much for watching the video.